क्यों? Okay, so students, now in this session we will discuss the remaining chapters. That is, we will start with the chapter photosynthesis in higher plants. Okay, so in the previous sessions we have completed up to the chapter mineral nutrition. Okay, so photosynthesis, what is photosynthesis? Photosynthesis is a physicochemical process by which green plants use light energy to derive the synthesis of organic compounds, and photosynthesis is an enzyme regulated anabolic process. Okay, and this is the basis of life on earth because it is the primary source of all food on earth, and photosynthesis is again responsible for the release of oxygen in the atmosphere, and the process of photosynthesis requires pigments like chlorophyll, okay, light energy as I said, and carbon dioxide. These three are compulsorily required for the process, and it occurs only in the green part of leaves and in the presence of light. Okay, so in this chapter we'll have a glance on the various aspects of this chapter. Firstly, let us discuss the early experiments, okay, and let us see the contribution of different scientists who have explained the various mechanisms involved in photosynthesis. Okay, the first one here goes, that is Joseph Priestley. Joseph Priestley conducted an experiment that is called as bell jar experiment, okay, or Priestley's experiment, and on the basis of his experiments he showed that essential role of air in the growth of green plants. Okay, he concluded that foul air which is produced by animals and foul air which is produced by a burning candle, that will be restored into pure air by the green plants. Okay, so what was his conclusion? In other words, I can say that Priestley hypothesized that plants restore the air whatever breathing animals and burning candles will remove. Okay, so this is the contribution of Joseph Priestley. Now let us go to the next contribution of another scientist, that is Julius van Sachs. Julius van Sachs shows that green part in plants produce glucose, which is stored in the form of starch. Okay, and starch is the first visible product of photosynthesis. There is another scientist, that is Jan Ingenhouse, who also conducted a very good experiment with an aquatic plant, and he showed that in bright sunlight only bubbles were formed around the green parts, while in the dark the bubbles were absent. Okay, so later he concluded that these bubbles were of basically oxygen gas. Okay, so ultimately it was proven by Ingenhouse that only the green part of the plant that could release oxygen. Now we have the contribution of another important scientist, that is T.W. Engelmann. Okay, so T.W. Engelmann conducted a very good experiment using a prism. Okay, using a prism he split light into different components or spectral components, and then he eliminated a green alga, that is Cladophora, and which was placed in a suspension of aerobic bacteria. He ultimately found that the bacteria accumulated in the blue and red part of the spectrum, and this concludes that the maximum rate of photosynthesis occurs in the blue light and red light, because maximum O2 evolution occurs in those light, in those regions. So Engelmann was the person who first gave the first action spectrum of photosynthesis, was in other words described by this person, Engelmann. Okay, next we have the contribution of Cornelius van Niel. So Cornelius van Niel, on the basis of studies with some purple and green sulfur bacteria, showed that photosynthesis is a light dependent reaction in which hydrogen from an oxidizable compound reduces carbon dioxide to form sugar. In those bacteria, when hydrogen sulfide was used instead of H2O, that is water, as a hydrogen donor, there was no evolution of oxygen. O2 was not evolved, children, and this infers that O2, which is evolved during photosynthesis, comes actually from water but not from carbon dioxide. So this aspect was also explained or demonstrated with the help of radioisotopic studies using O18 isotope of oxygen by another group of scientists, that is Ruben, Hassett and Kemen. Now where actually photosynthesis takes place, students, we all know that Photosynthesis occurs in the green in the specialized structures which are called as chloroplasts. Okay, so these structures are which are the sites of photosynthesis in eukaryotic photoautotrophs. Whereas in if you take some blue green algae and all which also do photosynthesis, there we have special structures which are called as chromatophores and all because they are prokaryotes. There actually it happens. But since we are discussing plants, we should remember chloroplast. Okay, so these chloroplasts basically have membranous system. Okay, stroma lamellae as well as the stroma. So membranous system is responsible to carry out the light reaction, in which ATP and NADPH, what we call them as assimilatory parts, are synthesized. Whereas in the stroma, enzymatic reactions incorporate in plants leading to synthesis of sugar. That means, in other words, in simple words, light reaction occurs in the membranous system and dark reaction occurs in the stroma part of chloroplast. Okay, so this is the site of photosynthesis. Now let us see which are the different pigments involved in photosynthesis. Students, we know that there are different pigments which take part or participate in photosynthesis, and how you are going to separate these pigments. There is a technique that is called as paper chromatography, and this chromatographic separation of pigments shows that color that we see in leaves. It is not due to a single pigment but due to four different pigments. Actually, which are those four different pigments? Chlorophyll A, which is bright or blue green in the chromatogram, chlorophyll B, which appears to be yellow green, xanthophylls, which appear to be yellow, and carotenoids, which show yellow to yellow orange coloration. So these four are together responsible for photosynthesis in higher plants. And among this, you should understand that chlorophyll A is considered to be the chief pigment and universal pigment. Okay, so and why chlorophyll A is supposed to be the chief pigment? Because chlorophyll A, if you look at the absorption spectrum of chlorophyll A, it exactly overlaps the action spectrum of photosynthesis. That is, maximum absorption of chlorophyll A occurs in blue, and the higher rate of photosynthesis also occurs in the same regions. That's why chlorophyll A is referred to as the chief pigment. It is referred to as the universal pigment because it is present in all oxygenic photosynthesizing organisms. Okay, all oxygenic photosynthesizing organisms. Okay, like if you take all higher plants, even if you take the blue green algae which also evolve oxygen, even if you take the euglenoids, etc., except the purple sulfur and green sulfur bacteria, which are anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. So chlorophyll A is the universal pigment. It is also called as a primary pigment, children. Why? Because it carries out the primary reaction or the photo conversion reaction of photosynthesis. So apart from this chlorophyll A, which is the primary pigment, the other pigments like chlorophyll B, xanthophylls, carotenoids are referred to as the accessory pigments. Okay, and these accessory pigments absorb light in the different parts of the spectrum. Okay, and they transfer the energy of absorption to chlorophyll A and protect them from photooxidation. Actually, accessory pigments does additional functions. They not only enable a wider range of wavelength of incoming light to be utilized, means they allow photosynthesis to occur at a wider range of wavelength, and also they protect the chlorophyll A from photo oxidation. So these are the roles of accessory pigments. So this is the diagrammatic or graphical representation of absorption of the different set of pigments like chlorophyll A, B and carotenoids. You can clearly see in this particular graph, chlorophyll A and even B shows maximum peak in the blue and red regions, whereas carotenoids show peak in the middle part of the spectrum. And the second graph here depicts the rate of photosynthesis, that is action spectrum. And the third, in the third graph, you can see that the action spectrum of photosynthesis is superimposed on absorption spectrum of chlorophyll A. Okay, so now let us move ahead. Now let us come to the next part, that is light reaction. As I've already said, students, photosynthesis occurs in two broad phases. One is called as a light reaction, another one is the dark reaction. So light reaction, also referred to as the photochemical phase, it includes certain important events like light absorption, water splitting, oxygen release, formation of high energy chemical intermediates, that is what we call as assimilatory parts, that is ATP and NADPH. Okay, so where actually this light reaction occur? As we know, it occurs in the membranous system, and how it happens to be is the pigments are organized into two discrete LHC. or the light harvesting complexes within the photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. Okay. And these are named according to their discovery. That's all. Okay. So what are these LSCs actually? The LSCs are actually made up of hundreds of pigment molecules which are bound to the proteins. Okay. So proteins and pigments together constitute the LHC, and each photosystem has all the pigments. Okay. Except one molecule of chlorophyll A, which forms the reaction center. There will be a single molecule of chlorophyll A which forms the reaction center, and remaining molecules are called as the antennae molecules. So this single chlorophyll A is forming the reaction center. As I said, it is a bit different from the other antennae molecules. Okay, so if you just look at the diagrammatic representation here of the LHC, you can see that different molecules are shown here in this picture, which are absorbing the light energy or the energy of the photon. You can see many pigment molecules. Only one which is centrally placed is called as the reaction center, which is chlorophyll A. Remaining are called as antennae or the core molecules. Okay. The function of this antennae or core molecules is to harvest the energy from photon and finally transfer it to the reaction center. Both accessory pigments, antennae and reaction center, both get excited. But you have to understand that excitation of reaction center is different from that of excitation of antennae molecule, because reaction center, once its excitation means it loses an electron, it undergoes photooxidation actually, whereas the antennae molecule do not lose electron. Their excitation means their electron is only shifted to the higher orbital. That makes the difference between the reaction center and the antennae molecule, and hence the reaction center, once it gets oxidized by losing the electron, transfers the electron to the primary acceptor, and finally electrons will be transferred to the successor electron carriers. And hence, as I said you, there are two photosystems, PS1 and PS2. And in PS1, chlorophyll A has an absorption peak at 700 nanometer, and in PS2, it has absorption peak or absorption maxima at 680 nanometer, and hence they are called as P700 or and P680. Okay, so this is about the light harvesting complex. Now, students, you know that once the reaction center is excited, it loses electron, as said, and now where this electron goes? That electron will be used up, the energy of the electron will be used up to actually synthesize ATP, and what that is what we call as photophosphorylation. So first of all, you should understand here phosphorylation. Phosphorylation is nothing but the process of in which the process of ATP synthesis by the cells, it can be in mitochondria, it can be in chloroplast, etc. That is called phosphorylation. So phosphorylation basically is of three types, if you just recall from your previous studies. One is substrate level phosphorylation, another is oxidative phosphorylation, and third one is the photophosphorylation. So substrate level phosphorylation, when any substrate donates its phosphate to ADP, ultimately forming ATP triphosphate, that is called substrate level phosphorylation. It can occur anywhere in the cytoplasm, even in the inside the stroma of the matrix of mitochondria, like that. Oxidative phosphorylation is one in which there is a terminal oxidation, and it happens in the inner membrane of mitochondria using ATPS complex. Okay, and one is the photophosphorylation, in which ATP is synthesized using the light energy. Okay, synthesis of ATP and inorganic from ADP and inorganic phosphate in the presence of light. So photophosphorylation is of two types, if you just recall. It is of how many types? Two types. One is called the cyclic photophosphorylation, another one is the non-cyclic photophosphorylation. So what is cyclic photophosphorylation? With the help of diagram, you can just see here, children. Cyclic means the flow of electron takes place in a cyclic manner. There is no external source of electron supply required here. Only one photosystem is involved, if you can see clearly in the diagram, that is PS1. What exactly happens in cyclic is the reaction center of PS1, that is P700, gets excited by absorbing light energy from the photon. And once it gets photooxidized, it transfers its electron to the primary acceptor. And electrons will be moving in uphill as well as in a downhill manner. Okay. From one redox potential to another redox potential, movement of electron can occur in an uphill manner from reaction center to primary acceptor, and then in a downhill manner. And during this transport of electrons, the energy of electron is used up to synthesize ATP, and this is called photophosphorylation. And electron is recycled back or donated back to the reaction center, hence it is called a cyclic process. And there is no external supply of electron, means there is no donor involved here. only one photosystem is involved here, and this is called as cyclic photophosphorylation. Now the question arises where this cyclic photophosphorylation occurs and when this occurs. So cyclic photophosphorylation occurs basically in this stroma lamellae, because in the membrane or the lamella of the grana they have both PS1 and PS2, but in stroma lamellae membranes lack PS2 as well as NADP reductase enzyme. What did I say? The stroma lamellae membranes lack PS2 as well as NADP reductase enzyme, and hence the excited electron does not pass to NADP plus, but it is cycled back to PS1. Okay, and that is the reason means the NADPH is not formed here. In cyclic phosphorylation only ATP is synthesized. Okay, there is only synthesis of ATP, and cyclic phosphorylation occurs when only wavelength of light beyond 680 nanometer is available for excitation. Okay, so this is about a cyclic process. Now we have the second process, that is nothing but the non-cyclic photophosphorylation. You can see clearly in the picture, also called as the Z scheme of photophosphorylation or light reaction. First thing what you should remember is two photosystems are involved, PS1 and PS2 both. What exactly happens is PS2, the reaction center of PS2 is excited by a photon, and once it loses electron, you can see in the diagram, it donates its electron to the primary acceptor. Primary acceptor in an uphill manner, okay, electron is donated in an uphill manner here, and then electron will pass in a downhill manner to the photosystem 1, that is P700. During this course, ATP is synthesized, okay, similar to that in a cyclic process, and P700 will further transfer the electron to the primary acceptor of PS1, and then finally the electron will be accepted by the NADP plus or NADP reductase, uses it, converting it to NADPH. Okay, so what things you have to remember is two photosystems are involved here. And another thing is, in non-cyclic, both ATP and NADPH are synthesized. Okay. And one more very important thing is, non-cyclic process is always associated with photolysis of water. So what is photolysis of water? If you just recall, splitting of water. Because, and this splitting of water is required because there must be a continuous supply of electron to the reaction center of PS2 children. Because PS2... once it loses electron, somebody should be there to replace that electron so that it should continuously do its work. And who is giving that electron? It is nothing but the water molecule. Okay, and this splitting of water molecule occurs with the help of an enzyme, that is OEC, what we call as oxygen evolving complex, with the help of metallic cofactors like manganese is one, calcium is one, and even chlorine is also involved. Okay, so and this continuous supply helped to carry out the process, and this way, this whole scheme, entire scheme of transfer of electron, which starts from PS2 uphill to the acceptor, then down the electron transport chain to PS1, then again excitation of the PS1, and finally downhill to NADP+, causing it to be reduced. This entire scheme is called as what? Z scheme of phosphorylation or Z scheme of photophosphorylation. Okay, so this is the these are the two methods of phosphorylation, cyclic and non-cyclic. So differences are highlighted here, as I have already mentioned. Like cyclic, if you take, performed by PS1 only independently, external source is not required. Yes, only ATP is synthesized and it occurs in the stroma or intergranule thylakoids. Whereas non-cyclic, if you take, performed by both collaboration of one PS1 and 2, process requires external electron donor, synthesizes ATP and NADPH both, and it occurs in the it occurs in the granule thylakoids only. Okay, so these are the differences which we have highlighted with respect to the cyclic and the non-cyclic processes. Okay, now let us come to the next concept here in this very chapter, which is again very important. It's called as chemiosmotic hypothesis of ATP formation. So what is this chemiosmotic coupling hypothesis, children? This hypothesis actually was proposed by Peter Mitchell in 1961. Okay, and this hypothesis explains ATP synthesis, and it says that it is linked to the development of proton gradient across the membrane of thylakoid and mitochondria. Okay, and this gradient is formed across the membrane of thylakoid due to some important reasons. Okay, so with the help of diagrammatic representation, you can understand here, okay, that is the process of chemiosmosis, diagrammatic representation. representation. The same figure which is given in your textbook is shown here on this slide. It is a bit blurred. You can refer to your textbook, but anyways, I'll try to just highlight the things here. So thylakoid membrane is displayed here, children, and two photosystems you can just see here. Okay, two photosystems, that is PS2 is here and PS1 is here. Okay, so PS2 gets excited after taking the energy of photon, transfers its electrons through electron carriers. That plastoquinone is one, okay, which is very important. And then plastoquinone will send it finally to cytochrome B6F here, actually. Okay, cytochrome BnF. And this cytochrome BF finally transfers to plastocyanin, and plastocyanin will finally transfer the electron to PS1 and ultimately reconverting NADP plus to NADPH. Okay, so this is the flow of electron actually, which occurs in a non-cyclic manner, okay, or non-cyclic photophosphorylation is shown here. So here, what you have to understand, the gradient is formed across the membrane. So there are reasons for this gradient formation. Okay, so what is the first major reason for this gradient formation is, so OEC, that is the oxygen evolving complex, which is located or associated with the PS2, it is located on the inner side of the membrane. You can just see this diagram. OEC is associated on the inner side of the membrane. So whenever water molecules are split, it is adding more and more protons to the lumen of thylakoid. So this is one reason concentration of proton builds up. Second reason is, as the electrons are moving through the photosystem, the protons are also transported across the membrane. Because you see, some of the electron carriers here will not accept only electron. They too accept, they definitely want some protons also. So they'll be taking protons from the matrix, and finally these will be again sent back to the lumen of the thylakoid. I hope you are understanding. These molecules remove the protons from the stroma or the matrix and for the transfer of electrons, and these protons ultimately will be thrown in the lumen of the membrane. So that is the second reason why proton concentration builds up here. Third reason you can see here with the help of this diagram, the enzyme NADP reductase is located on the stroma side of the membrane, or you can see, I can tell, outer side of the thylakoid membrane or towards the stroma side of the thylakoid membrane. So whenever NADP plus is converted to NADPH, this enzyme basically is using some protons from the stroma, okay, and that leads to reduction of or the lowering the concentration of protons in the stroma, okay. So I hope you have understood here. Protons is splitting of water and transfer of protons from the stroma to the lumen. Protons are added. By this third thing, protons are removed from the stroma. So these three things ultimately are responsible for building up a concentration gradient which is formed across the thylakoid membrane, and that is ultimately playing a role in the synthesis of ATP. So how it happens in the synthesis of ATP, if you just see here, okay, so the ATP synthesis occurs by the help of an enzyme. And that enzyme is called as ATPase, children. And this ATPase consists of two parts. One is called as the F0 and the F1. F0 is embedded in the membrane and forms a transmembrane channel, whereas F1 is protruding outside. Okay, so outside the thylakoid membrane here, the side that faces the stroma. So they break down the gradient that by providing enough energy to cause a conformational change. When protons are transported, okay, it creates a conformational change in the structure of F1 particle, which makes the enzyme synthesize several molecules of ATP. Okay, so basically you should understand, chemiosmosis requires a membrane compulsorily, a pump is required compulsorily, proton pump, a proton gradient, and ATPase. Okay, so with these things, ATP molecules are synthesized, and this synthesis of ATP is ultimately called as what? Photophosphorylation. Now we'll come to the next part in this chapter. With the completion of light reaction, you have to understand the next phase is the dark reaction. So dark reaction occurs, how dark reaction occurs by different pathways. If you just recall, one is called as the Kelvin cycle or the C3 cycle. Kelvin, based on the name of scientist Melvin Kelvin and his co-workers, who worked out to demonstrate the whole pathway. So Kelvin cycle involves three steps, children, as you can just recall. one is called as carboxylation, another one is called as reduction, and third one is called as regeneration. So what is this carboxylation? If you just see in the diagram, carboxylation is the very first step, which is nothing but fixation of CO2 into a stable organic intermediate. So which is the stable, first stable compound? The first stable compound is nothing but 3-phosphoglycerate or the 3-phosphoglyceric acid. So what is actually happening here is the carbon, atmospheric carbon dioxide that enters, it combines with a primary acceptor. That acceptor is a 5C molecule, that is ribulose 1,5-biphosphate. So this 5C plus 1, actually what we expect is 6C molecule should form, but actually we are getting two molecules of 3-phosphoglycerate, and this 3-phosphoglycerate contains 3 carbon atoms. Okay, so how many carbon atoms? 3 carbon atoms. So this is the first step, or that's called as carboxylation, and then reduction. So in reduction, what happens? There are series of reactions actually, and that ultimately lead to the formation of triose phosphate, okay, and finally glucose, and then sucrose, and finally starch. Okay, so what is happening in reduction? In one simple way, I can tell you that reduction generally is the reversal of many of the steps of reduction, or the reversal of glycolysis. Children, in glycolysis, oxidation occurs, whereas in reduction, you can see things are getting reduced. Okay, reverse of glycolytic reactions occur here, finally forming glucose. And important thing here is, During reduction process, two molecules of ATP for phosphorylation and two molecules of NADPH for reduction per carbon dioxide molecules are fixed, are utilized. Very important. Reduction steps involve utilization of two molecules of ATP and two molecules of NADPH for reduction per carbon dioxide molecule fixed. Okay, so two here and two here. And finally, we have the last step, that is regeneration. Regeneration is nothing but ribulose 1,5-biphosphate is reformed or regenerated. And this step will require one ATP, single ATP. So overall, you should say that for one carbon dioxide, 3 ATP and 1 NADPH. Whereas to form one glucose, 6 carbon dioxide are used, we know that. And hence, 18 ATPs and 12 NADPH molecules will be utilized. So this is Kelvin cycle, and carbon fixation also occurs by one more method, that is called a C4 cycle or the hatch and slack pathway. Okay, why it is called C4? Because the first stable product that is formed contains 4 carbon atoms, and that is oxaloacetic acid. Okay, and where does this occur? This occurs in the C4 plants, which have special type of leaf anatomy, children, that is called as trans anatomy. These plants are highly tolerant to temperature and response to high light intensities. They, and also very important thing, they do not have photorespiration. Okay, so these are the special features of the C4 plants, like maize is an example, sugarcane is an example, etc. Sorghum is an example. Like that. So here in C4 cycle, trans anatomy is present as it. So what is the trans anatomy? The bundle sheath cells, which are present in the leaf, they form several layers around the vascular bundles actually, and they are characterized by having a large number of chloroplasts, thick walls, and they are impervious to gaseous exchange. They do not have intercellular spaces. So going looking into the highlights of this cycle, you can just see two cells are shown here. One is mesophyll, one is bundle sheath cells. First thing you have to understand, in mesophyll cells, Rubisco enzyme is absent. In bundle sheath cell, Rubisco enzyme is present. That is the first important thing. Another thing is, in mesophyll cell, one enzyme is present, that is PEP carboxylase, phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase, which carries out the first step of carbon fixation here. So primary fixation occurs in the mesophyll cells. PEP is the primary acceptor, which is already having 3 carbons. It accepts CO2 and forms a first stable product, oxaloacetic acid. Oxaloacetic acid, C4 acid, which is shown here, and this C4 acid will be transported finally to the bundle sheath cells here, okay, in the form of aspartic acid or malic acid, and then when in the bundle sheath cells, decarboxylation occurs by C4 acid and ultimately releasing carbon dioxide, which undergoes Kelvin cycle with the help of the enzyme Rubisco. Rubisco is present here, as I said, and C3 acid is transported back to the mesophyll cells here. So this is cyclic representation. Okay, important thing you have to just remember here in C4 plants is they are highly resistant to adverse conditions. Okay, and another important thing is photorespiration is absent in this kind of plant. This is very, very important feature of the C4 plants. Okay, So now moving ahead to the next part in this chapter, that is photorespiration. Yes, sir. What is photorespiration? It is a light dependent process of oxygenation of RUBP and release of carbon dioxide by photosynthetic organs of plants. Photorespiration decreases the rate of photosynthesis actually. And why this happens? Because I would like to tell you that the enzyme Rubisco has binding sites for both oxygen and carbon dioxide. That means it can behave as carboxylase, even it can behave as oxygenase. Okay, the ratio of CO2 to oxygen is influential. Okay, for the activity of this enzyme, when O2 concentration is high, this enzyme behaves as oxygenase, combines with oxygen to form phosphoglyceric acid and phosphoglycolate. Okay, and this phosphoglycolate takes up the pathway of photorespiration. Okay, and in this photorespiratory pathway, you have to understand there is neither any synthesis of sugars nor any ATP. Rather, it is resulting in the release of CO2, and ATP is rather consumed. Okay, so it is using energy. Okay, rather than producing energy. So it is said that photorespiration is a wasteful process, and this pathway involves three important organelles, that is chloroplast, peroxisome and mitochondria, which function in a coordinated manner and carry out photorespiration. And in C4 plants, it is absent, as I said, because there are many reasons. One is bundle sheet cells are thick walled cells. Okay, they don't release carbon dioxide will be released there, so CO2 concentration is very high, so they do not allow any kind of photorespiration because of high intracellular CO2 concentration, and hence Rubisco there will be functioning as carboxylase. Okay, so this is one concept. Now, let us come to the last part of this chapter, Blackman's law of limiting factor, that is factors affecting photosynthesis. So, there are many factors actually that affect the chemical process. Blackman's law of limiting factor comes into effect here, and it states that if a chemical process is affected by more than one factor, then its rate will be determined by the factor which is nearest to its minimal value. It is the factor which directly affects the process if its quantity is changed. Okay, and hence we have to understand that there are different factors that affect photosynthesis, like light, carbon dioxide concentration, temperature, water, etc., etc. Okay, and all these factors, the factors can be actually, children, intrinsic as well as extrinsic. Okay, multiple factors will be there which all together affect the process of photosynthesis. So with this, we have seen this chapter at a glance. Now, let us go to the next chapter, students, that is nothing but respiration in plants. Okay. So rather, this is a chapter which is in continuity with photosynthesis. Interesting chapter. So what is respiration in plants? Respiration, if you just recall, what is respiration? Basically, respiration is an energy-releasing, enzymatically controlled process. Okay, catabolic process. In a true sense, it should be called as anabolic actually. Cellular respiration is the mechanism of breaking down of food material within the cell to release energy for synthesis of ATP. And this breaking down of complex molecules takes place to produce energy in cytoplasm as well as in mitochondria. And there is a concept that is called respiratory substrates. What are these? The compounds that get oxidized are called respiratory substrates. And this happens due to breaking down of C-C bonds of complex compounds through oxidation within the cells, leading to release of energy. This is actually called as respiration. And ATP, as we all know, it is the energy currency of the cell. Process of respiration requires oxygen, of course, but if it is anaerobic, the statement would not be correct. But generally in aerobic, oxygen is compulsorily required. And we know that plants can get along without any respiratory organs. There are reasons for that. Each plant part takes care of its own gaseous exchange needs. Plants do not present great demands for gaseous exchange. And the distance that gases must diffuse in large plant is not great also. And O2 is released in photosynthesis, which is sufficient to diffuse to other parts of the plant system. So cellular respiration concept, if you see, children, there is a common pathway that is called as glycolysis. Okay, and this glycolysis can take up either aerobic processes or anaerobic processes. In aerobic processes, we have Krebs cycle and terminal oxidation, that is ETS, electron transport system. In anaerobic respiration, we have lactic acid fermentation and alcoholic fermentation. You have to understand that glycolysis is a common pathway which must occur in all living cells. Okay, it is a common pathway even in aerobic as well as anaerobic systems. Okay. Now, glycolysis. So, glycolysis, what is this glycolysis? It is also called as EMP pathway based on the name of scientist, okay? Occurs in the cytoplasm and is present in all living organisms, as I said, okay? So, what is happening here, if you just see, I have just given the flow chart here, okay, steps of glycolysis, and by seeing itself, you should be able to understand what are the steps here. So, it is a 10-step enzyme-mediated pathway, children, okay. So, what you have to understand is 6C molecule is converted to 2 molecules of pyruvic acid, that is 3C compounds, okay. Each step is catalyzed by a specific enzyme, and what ultimate thing you have to remember is, the first phase is called preparatory phase, where the cell has to spend energy or ATP molecules to molecules of ATP will have to be spent here in the first phase, and in the second phase energy is produced actually, that is by substrate level phosphorylation. You can see two substrate level phosphorylations here in this particular flow chart. Two substrate level phosphorylation, okay, this is one and this is one, and one molecule of water is lost here also, okay, dehydration step also is there. And important thing here is, during this process, oxidative phosphorylation also occurs here. So you can see here NADH is produced here, and this NADH, one molecule of NADH per triosphosphate. In other words, two molecules you get here actually overall. And this NADH is ultimately responsible for the synthesis of three molecules of ATP when it enters the ETC or the electron transport chain. Okay. So there are different steps here. Isomerization, okay. Phosphorylation, isomerization, okay. Ultimately dehydration, okay. And even substrate level phosphorylation. So ultimately what you get is two molecules of 3C compound. Glucose is said to be partially oxidized. This is very important. There is partial oxidation that is occurring for glucose, okay, not the complete oxidation. So the net gain, if you just recall, how many molecules of ATP you get out of glycolysis is, you get 8 molecules, okay, 8 molecules of ATP, because 2 NADH, that will give you 6 molecules here, 6 into 2 into 3, 6 ATP molecules you will get here, and 6 plus 6 plus 4 actually, minus 2 you have to do, so actually you will end up with how many? 8 molecules of ATPs. Now, after glycolysis, as I said, you either it can enter into aerobic process or anaerobic process, okay? Anaerobic process are generally called as fermentations, okay? And fermentations are of two types, as I already mentioned. One is lactic acid fermentation and another one is the alcoholic fermentation, okay? So, what is this lactic acid fermentation? Here you can see lactic acid fermentation occurs in lactic acid bacteria, that is lactobacilli, okay? And even it can occur under anaerobic condition in the muscles of our body, okay? In the muscles, in the absence of oxygen, lactic acid can be synthesized. Okay. So, how this happens actually is, the pyruvic acid which is formed will undergo further steps of fermentation in the absence of oxygen. In lactic acid fermentation, it is a single step process, you must remember, because one 3C compound is converting to another 3C compound. Lactic acid also has three carbons, okay. But important thing here is, the NADH which is produced during glycolysis is used up, children, okay. It is further oxidized. NADH is oxidized to NAD plus. In the due course, pyruvic acid is reduced to lactic acid. So you have to understand, whatever NADH was produced, which was yielding ATP, that process will not be there here actually. So the overall net result, fermentation will give us only 2 ATP molecules, okay. Fermentation would yield how many? Only 2 ATP molecules, because this NADH is used up in this conversion. So energy yield is very low in fermentation, we say. Similarly, when you come to it, alcoholic fermentation in yeast cells, so it is a 2-step process actually, where pyruvic acid is first converted to acetaldehyde. So first step, pyruvic acid is converted to acetaldehyde, means it is a decarboxylation, okay, and the enzyme involved is pyruvate decarboxylase here. For lactic acid, the enzyme involved is lactate dehydrogenase, children. So here in pyruvic acid to acetaldehyde, when CO2 is evolved, so that is shown here actually, that CO2 is evolved in the first step actually, and then acetaldehyde will undergo redox reaction to produce ethanol. Okay, so acetaldehyde now will undergo reduction, because here also an NADH is used up to form NAD plus. Okay, so here you understand, for for conversion of pyruvate to ethanol, two steps. First step, acetaldehyde is formed by decarboxylation. Second step, acetaldehyde is reduced to alcohol. In the due course, NADH is oxidized to NAD+. And final products of this fermentation is alcohol and carbon dioxide occurs in the yeast cells in the absence of oxygen. So these are the steps of anaerobic respiration. Now we'll come to the next part, that is nothing but the Krebs cycle. Okay, so Krebs cycle, this is a process of aerobic respiration, also called as TCA cycle, okay, or Krebs cycle. TCA because tricarboxylic acid, a very simple cyclic path. I'll just tell you what are the highlights about this. Okay, pyruvate will enter the mitochondria and gets converted to acetyl CoA children, and this step is catalyzed by the enzyme what pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. Okay, during this process UT is evolved, NAD plus is converted to NADH. Acetyl CoA 2C compound enters the cycle, okay, where acceptor is 4C compound, forms the first stable product, that is citric acid, which is having 6 carbon. So cycle is also called as citric acid cycle. And in a series of cyclic reactions, you can see that citric acid will be converted to ultimately or recycled to form the oxaloacetic acid. Important thing, during this process lot many changes occur. NADH, many NADH molecules are produced here. Okay, so during the first conversion, decarboxylations occur. So two decarboxylations occur here actually, because 6C is converting to 4C. So two times carbon dioxide is evolved here in the Krebs cycle. Similarly, NADH molecules, 3 NADH molecules are formed here. Okay, that means 3 dehydrogenations, 1, 2 and 3 dehydrogenation, and one more dehydrogenation with respect to FAD, because one molecule of FADH2 also you get per cycle. So you have to understand one thing, that 6C is converted to 4C by 2 decarboxylation, and totally 1, 2, 3, 4 dehydrogenations occur here. And one very important thing, one substrate level phosphorylation occurs in the cycle where GTP is formed, and finally this GTP is converted to ATP. Okay, so the overall, by this actually what is the result, ultimate result is glucose is completely oxidized to form carbon dioxide and water. This is very important. Glucose finally is oxidized to form carbon dioxide and water. So these are the end products of complete oxidation of glucose. So if you take one pyruvic acid, one cycle, okay, so in one cycle you get 4 NADH, 1 FADH2, okay, and 1 ATP. In two cycles you have to just double the number and you will get final water and CO2 as the end products of Krebs cycle. Okay, so after the Krebs cycle is over, now finally the NADH, the reducing equivalent, that is NADH2 and FADH2, now have to enter the electron transport chain. So electron transport chain, where it is located, you know, it is located in the inner mitochondrial membrane, and this electron transport chain is consisting of 5 complexes, children. There are 5 complexes. The first one is called as NADH dehydrogenase complex. Second one is called as complex 2, that is ubiquinone succinate dehydrogenase complex. Okay, and the third one is called as cytochrome BC1 complex, and fourth one is called as cytochrome C3 oxidase complex, and last one is the ATPase complex. So here, due to the time factor, I have to just tell you that electrons will be passing through the series of electron carriers. I cannot go into much details here. And what you have to remember is their pathway can be either through complex 1, 3 and 4 and 5, or it can be through, for NADH, the pathway can be complex 1, 3, 4 and 5. Similarly, for FADH2, the pathway can be complex 2, 3, 4 and 5, children. I hope you are understanding. 1, 3, 4 and 5 for NADH, and for FADH2, it can be 2, 3, 4 and 5. Okay. Final terminal electron acceptor is oxygen here. That's why it is called oxidative phosphorylation. Okay, and you have to understand that during this transport of electrons, protons are thrown in the intermembrane space that builds up a proton gradient. Okay, and these protons have to be thrown back into the matrix. Okay, and the energy of these protons is used up for the synthesis of ATP. Okay, and that is called as oxidative phosphorylation. So this happens in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So ultimately you have to understand, one NADH2 as per this diagram is pumping nearly 10 protons and one FADH2 is pumping 8 protons. As per your NCERT diagram, I am telling one NADH2 is pumping or throwing 10 protons and one FADH2 is throwing 8 protons in the intermembrane space. And one NADH2 is responsible for the synthesis of 3 ATP equivalent and one FADH2 for 2 ATP equivalents. Okay. Now, respiratory balance sheet is there. So, with respect to respiratory balance sheet, there are certain criteria, okay? Like glucose is the only respiratory substrate, sequential in order, proper sequential order it occurs, NADH enters the mitochondria, etc., etc. With these all assumptions, you can conclude that for one molecule of glucose, there can be a net gain of 36 ATP molecules, okay, during aerobic respiration. How many? 36. Whereas in fermentation, as I've already said, there are only 2 molecules of ATP for each molecule of glucose degraded to pyruvic acid. So the there is lot of difference between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. There 36 you get, and here you get only 2 molecules of ATP. Okay, so and you should also know that respiration is also called as amphibolic pathway. Why it is called amphibolic pathway? Because it involves both catabolism as well as anabolism. This diagram itself depicts these things very clearly. These carbohydrates, which are like sugars, like glucose and all, enters into glycolytic pathway, and they can even be synthesized. Okay, they can even, like glycolysis can even be taken up by the fat molecules by forming fatty acid and glycerol can enter by forming dihydroxyacetone phosphate. So this is catabolism also, anabolism also. Like proteins can split into amino acid, and amino acid can form the pyruvic acid. Okay, and similarly, fatty acids can give rise to acetyl CoA by catabolic pathways. So catabolism is also involved, and many of the intermediates of Krebs cycle. For example, if you take alpha-ketoglutaric acid, succinic acid, these are used for synthesis reactions. So, for example, alpha-ketoglutaric acid is used for the synthesis of many amino acids, children. Okay, and chlorophyll is synthesized by some of the intermediates of the Krebs cycle. Okay, so in other words, I can say that overall, respiration is an amphibolic, means it involves both anabolism and catabolism. So in the last part in this chapter is respiratory quotient. So respiratory quotient, what is RQ? It's the ratio of volume of CO2 evolved upon volume of oxygen consumed, and it depends upon the type of substrate used up. So for example, when carbohydrates are used, it will be 1. When fats are used, it is less than 1. Even when proteins are used, it is less than 1, that is nearly about 0.9. So now let us have a glance quickly on the last chapter of this session, that is plant growth and development. So in plant growth and development, you have studied that there are different parts like root, stems, etc., which arise in an orderly manner in plants. Okay, there are sequences of growth which are followed in a proper fashion, and plants complete their vegetative phase to move into reproductive phase, in which flower and fruits are formed by continuation of life cycle. And development, what is development? Basically, development is the sum total of two processes, children. One is growth, another one is the differentiation, and both intrinsic and extrinsic factors play a role there. So growth is a permanent or irreversible increase in drive, weight, size, mass or volume of cell or in an organ or organism. It is internal or intrinsic to living beings. And plant growth is generally indeterminate. What is the meaning? Indeterminate due to the capacity of unlimited growth throughout the life. And why this happens? Due to the presence of meristematic tissue. Okay, and plant growth is also called as open form of growth, you should know. Why? Because new cells are always being added to the plant body. And which tissue is participating? I have already said root apical and shoot apical meristem are participating here. And secondary growth occurs by means of what? Lateral meristem. Okay, so that is formation of cork, cambium, phellem, phelloderm, etc., etc. So growth is measurable also. You can measure the growth in by there are different parameters by which you can measure, like fresh weight, length, area, volume, cell number, etc. And these parameters would help to measure the growth in a proper fashion. And ultimate, sometimes it is very difficult to measure the increase in amount of protoplasm, but increase in cells, cell number and cell size can of course be measured. So there are different phases. Okay, So there are different phases of growth, that is called as formative phase, okay, then phase of enlargement, etc. So period of growth is generally divided into actually three phases: meristematic, elongation, and maturation actually. So these meristematic, for example, the constantly dividing cells both at root and shoot apex represent the meristematic growth. The cells in this region will be rich in protoplasm and they possess large conspicuous nuclei, okay. And elongation, if you take, okay, the cells in proximal just to the meristematic region are representing the elongation phase. They have increased vacuolation, okay, they have increased vacuolation, cell, they undergo enlargement, new cell wall deposition. These are the characteristics of phase of elongation. And cell enlargement occurs in all directions with maximum elongation in conducting tissues and fibers. So growth rate, now coming to the, and now last one we have phase of maturation, I'm sorry. So what is this phase of maturation? So the cells in this zone attain their maximum size, children, in terms of thickening, protoplasmic modification, etc. And that is maturation. And growth rate, how do you define growth rate? Increase in growth per unit time is called growth rate. Maybe arithmetic or geometrical. So arithmetic growth rate, how it is expressed? Arithmetic growth rate mathematically is expressed by this particular relationship, that is LT is equal to L naught plus RT, where LT is length at time T, L naught is at time zero, okay, actually, and that is R is what here, R is growth rate or elongation per unit time, okay. So this is the way of representing arithmetic growth. Similarly, geometric growth is expressed with the help of an equation, that is Wn is equal to W naught e power RT. So where W1 represents the final size, W naught initial size, okay. R is again growth rate, T for time, and E is the base of natural logarithm. Okay, so this is the graphical representation of linear growth. Okay, a plot of length against time here, whereas this is the representation of sigmoid, idealized sigmoid growth curve, typical for cells in culture and even for higher plants. Okay, you can see there are different phases: lag phase, exponential phase, stationary phase, etc. Okay, so if you just see these phases, among these, exponential phase is the phase of the maximum growth here. And quantitative comparison between growth can be absolute growth. Measurement and comparison of total growth per unit time is called absolute rate, and the growth of given system per unit time expressed on a common basis is called as the relative growth rate. Okay, so there are two methods here, one is the absolute, another one is the relative growth rate. In this chapter, you have also studied the concept of differentiation, de-differentiation, and re-differentiation. Okay, so what is differentiation? The cells which are actually produced by apical meristem, they become specialized, children, to perform specific function. This act of maturation is called as differentiation. Okay, they undergo actually many types of structural changes in their cell walls, protoplasm, etc. Okay, like if you take the example of trachea elements of xylem, they become dead by losing their protoplasm like that. Some cells develop elasticity. Okay, they show deposition of lignin and cellulose in their walls. All these things lead to differentiation. Similarly, concept of de-differentiation, have lost the ability of division, can regain the capacity of division once again. This phenomenon is called as de-differentiation. For example, if you take intrafascicular cambium and cork cambium, okay, they from the fully differentiated parenchyma cells, they such meristem tissue are able to divide, as we all know, and produce cells that once again lose the capacity to divide, but once again mature to form specific function. That is called as re-differentiation. So what happens in re-differentiation? De-differentiated cells mature and lose the capacity of cell division again to perform specific function. This process is called as re-differentiation. Okay, so development, concept of development. What is development? It is a sequence of events that occur in the life history of cell, organ or organism, which includes seed germination, growth, differentiation, etc. You have studied a concept that is called plasticity. What is plasticity? Different structures develop in different phases of growth as well as in response to environment. The ability to change under the influence of internal external stimuli is called as plasticity. Okay. In other words, plants follow different pathways in response to environment or phases of life to form different kinds of structures. This is called as plasticity. Examples quoted are heterophily in a case of cotton, heterophily in case of larkspur, buttercup, etc. These are the examples. Now the last part of this chapter is plant growth regulators, and which are nothing but the plant growth hormones. They can be chemically they can be different compounds, like they can be derivatives of adenine, derivatives of carotenoids, etc. And they were discovered by different scientists. For example, auxin was isolated by Wendt from the tips of coleoptile of oat seedlings. Pekinese disease of rice seedling was caused by fungal pathogen Gibberella fujicuri, which was reported by E. Kurosawa. Skoog and Miller identified and crystallized the cytokine which promote cell division, actually promoting cell division, and they are also called as kinetins. Auxin, functions of auxin, what are the major functions of auxin? Cell enlargement, promotes apical dominance, cell division, inhibition of abscission, and also responsible for induction of parthenocarpy. Similarly, gibberellins, there are many gibberellins reported as promotory PGR. Okay, they are reported to be present in more than 100 forms, but the common one which is used is gibberellic acid, which is designated as GA3. Okay, they perform multiple functions. They, like for example, they are used to increase the length of axis, used to increase the length of grape stalks. Okay, they cause fruits like apple to elongate and improve its shape. They delay senescence. Okay, and sugarcane particularly, which stores carbohydrate as sugar. Okay, spraying this sugarcane with gibberellins or gibberellic acid increase the length of this stem, and yield can be increased nearly about 20 tons per acre. So these are the multiple functions of gibberellins. Okay, similarly we have cytokinins, which hormones which are basic in nature. Most common of them are kinetin and zeatin. Okay, they also are known for multiple type of functions. Okay, so natural cytokinins are actually synthesized in regions where rapid cell division occurs. Okay, for help to overcome apical dominance. Okay, they promote nutrient mobilization, which is very very important role. Okay, promoting nutrient mobilization, which helps in the delay of leaf senescence. Similarly, ethylene is another plant growth regulator, which is in a gaseous state, gaseous hormone. Okay, ethylene breaks seed and bud dormancy. This is very important function. Initiate germination in peanut seeds, sprouting of potato tubers. This is also one more function if you just remember. And ethylene is known to promote root growth and root hair formation. That is also one role. It induces flowering in mango. Okay, ethylene. And the most widely used compound is called ethephon. I am stressing ethephon, which is commonly used compound as a source of ethylene, which is in an aqueous solution actually. Okay, so that is used. So it helps fruit ripening in tomatoes, apples, etc., etc. Abscisic acid. So abscisic acid, ABA, which is also called as stress hormone or dormin. Okay, and responsible for multiple functions. Okay, it plays a role in seed development, maturation, and dormancy. Okay, it helps the seeds to withstand desiccation, if you just remember. And it's in major of this situation, it is acting as antagonistic to gibberellic acid. You must remember this is in one line. Antagonistic hormone to gibberellic acid is abscisic acid. Okay, and this here we have one more concept that is called as photoperiodism. So what is photoperiodism? The effect of photoperiods or day duration of light hours on the growth and development of plant, especially flowering, is called photoperiodism. Based on that, we have three types of plants or three categories: short day plants, long day plants, and day neutral plants. Okay, so short day plants are those which require the exposure of light for a period exceeding a well-defined critical duration. Okay, when they exceed the critical duration, they are called as long day plants. And within that, if they use, while others, when they are exposed to light for a period less than this critical duration, they are called short day. More than the critical duration, they are called as long day plants. Okay, then we have day neutral plants also, where such correlation is not there actually. Okay, so such response are not there, responses are not there, they are called as day neutral plants. Okay, so this is one concept here. And last concept what you have studied in this chapter is vernalization. What is vernalization? This is the process of actually for shortening or of the juvenile or vegetative phase and stimulating the flowering period by cold treatment. Okay, this helps in shortening of vegetative period, bringing about early flowering. And this vernalization is under the influence of hormones. One of the important hormone what I can recall is vernalin, which is basically responsible for this. Okay, and this response of plant is a very interesting concept. Okay, it is interesting to just remember that shoot apices will modify themselves actually to form the flowering apices. Okay, and this happens, the site of perception, basically if you just remember, of light and dark duration are the leaves, children. Okay, and that is responsible for flowering, and this hormone will be migrating from leaves to shoot apices for inducing flowering only when it is exposed to the inductive period. And this is one concept you have to remember. So these are the things here with respect to this chapter. Hope we were able to highlight the basic concepts here. So with this, let us have a conclusion of this chapter. Madam?
Yeah, madam. Hello.
Yeah, we can stop.
Okay.